Penguin poop always gets a bit of a laugh.
When penguins get together, they poop all over the pebbles.
Can we call them guano stains, please?
Oh, so what is guano?
Poop. Poop. You can see the areas where the penguins have been breeding because it's just covered with poop, and that poop is red, and it's really distinctive from the rock surface that's around it.
We're not relying on seeing individual penguins, but we're relying on seeing this guano stain that they leave on the landscape.
When I was a grad student at Michigan, I was studying vegetation from space. And one of the advisors on my dissertation committee, he, at one point or another, he asked me the question about whether you could see penguins from space. And it seemed like satellite remote sensing would be the ticket. I published a paper on the measurements that I made saying that, yeah, this could be feasible. This is a CCT, a computer compatible tape. So this was the technology in the 1980s. And if you wanted to actually collect the data to do a full continent search for daily penguin colonies, we need a stack of tapes about the size of a tall tree. And then, of course, each tape costs $3,000 if you needed 200 or so, and that would be $600,000 worth of tape. And of course, everybody loves penguins, but nobody loves penguins that much. The technology just wasn't there. It was impossible. I put this on ice until 2008.
I don't want to do science in a vacuum. I want to do science that is sensitive to the ongoing debates that matter to the environment. That's very much been the driving force of my own work in Antarctica. Now, this is the traditional way that we count penguins. We actually go to Antarctica and we count them one by one. But this is incredibly labor intensive, and it's just not possible to survey all of the penguin colonies in Antarctica that we need. So I started digging through the literature, and I found these old papers from a researcher named Matt Schwaller. Now these papers were from the mid-1980s. I just sort of assumed that Matt had maybe retired or had just completely stopped thinking about penguins.
Yeah, well, I was not living under a rock, but I was busy with the other aspects of my career. After 2008, I could just pick up as much data as I wanted for free on a fairly high-speed internet connection. So all of a sudden, boom, I had, you know, unlimited data.
So I remember distinctly that first phone call that I had with Matt that was like, you know, talking to one of your idols, because his initial work had been so critical to my thinking about how we might use satellite imagery. And so we've been working together ever since, I think almost 14 years now. We wrote this proposal to NASA to expand our work and to build a decision support tool that would make sure that policymakers were getting as close to real-time information on penguin populations as possible. When this grant was ultimately funded, we had the opportunity to bring on a postdoc to work on that project, and Chris was the perfect person to take that role because of his background in statistical modeling and computer programming.
What I really like is trying to have a model of why something is happening biologically and to formulate that model using statistical language or statistical models. That guano stain or poop stain on the ground is proportional roughly to the number of birds that are breeding at that site in a year. If we can say something about how the populations of these birds are changing over time, we can potentially say something about something larger about like what's going on in marine ecosystems.
And so the goal was to create a browser-based tool that anybody on the internet could go to, and they could immediately find the best available information on how many penguins there are in Antarctica, how their populations have changed over time, and what we might expect for the future. We completed, I think, the first version of this tool in around 2016, 2017, and it's been in regular use by policymakers since then. So one of the big decisions that policymakers need to make is to design what are called marine protected areas. It was clear that there were some enormous penguin colonies in this chain of islands called the Danger Islands.
There were just, I think, 200 or so pixels on that one island, and it turned out to be a really big colony.
And in response, the marine protected area for the Western Antarctic Peninsula was expanded by something like 2 million hectares to include the Danger Islands. The Danger Islands was such a nice example of how when we discover things, we can make sure that the best science is actually driving the conservation and management decisions.
It's really been just a thrill and an honor, and just personally rewarding to work with Chris and with Heather.
So it feels pretty good as a scientist to know that the work I'm doing could have these impacts.
We're just sort of at the beginning of what it means to do ecology from space. There is a very active community of ecologists that are now using satellite imagery to track everything from, you know, elephants to, you know, walruses. Matt was way ahead of his time, you know, thinking of this in the mid-1980s, but I think the computation and the computing power and the availability of imagery has really caught up with this, you know, kind of quirky idea that we might be able to see penguins from space and actually use that for conservation.